You've popped the question, and all of a sudden, you are talking nonstop about your wedding day plans. The DJ, the florist, the cake, the location. Well, should that be your focus? Or should it be every day after? Today, we learn more about prenuptial agreements and divorce. Thanks for listening and subscribing to Learning More, where each episode we bring you a new story about people, inventions, pop culture, and life. I'm your host, Russ. And this week, we're discussing family law, specifically prenuptial agreements and divorce. Okay, throughout my 20s and 30s, I attended about 2,000 weddings. Yeah, I know. It sounds like I'm exaggerating. I'm not. I might actually be underreporting a bit. Yeah, see, I was a wedding DJ. Yeah, so that means lots of prime rib, lots of wedding cakes, and lots of odd dances. I saw a lot. I saw a collapsing wedding cake one time. Yeah, the sun was coming in through the tent, and it just heated everything up, and the cake actually fell down during the best man toast. Yeah, bad timing. Yeah, well, I guess no timing would be good for that one, but that one was particularly bad. One time I saw a parent of the bride being arrested. Yeah, the father of the bride being carted away in handcuffs because of a altercation on the dance floor. I saw a lot, definitely. An upset groom when the bride didn't show up. And a marriage actually literally start to break down before the cake was even cut. I saw a lot in doing over 2,000 weddings. Working in the wedding industry can definitely be difficult. And it's not due to the work, right? Like, okay, moving equipment, getting everything set up, all the pressure. That is a lot, but really it's the emotion, all of the emotion that is wrapped up into that one day. What I would generally say to my couples that I worked with at one of our first meetings, I would say two things. One is that having a perfect wedding is impossible. Something is going to go wrong, but don't let that one thing ruin everything. And the second thing I would tell them is that I would say that despite what all the wedding books, the websites, and other professionals say, it's not the most important day of your life. Yeah, I would actually say that to clients. Yeah, it's a big day. You know, I'll agree with that. But it's not the most important day. It is just the beginning. Okay, so in this role as a wedding DJ, I saw thousands of unions. But just statistically, of course, I'm going to see divorces. So I actually saw hundreds of divorces during this time. And divorce is a tough topic. I mean, it almost feels like I'm saying a curse word when I say it into the microphone. However, like many other difficult topics that we bring to light on this show, we should talk about it. We should also talk about the prenuptial agreement. So that if things do go south in your marriage, you're both protected. To discuss this with me today, I am joined by a lawyer from Florida that has been voted one of the best in the state. She has helped couples through this difficult process and has a reason for getting a prenuptial agreement that you may not have thought of before. I'm joined by Dolly Hernandez. She represents high net worth individuals in complex marital and family law matters, and she's a partner at Boyd, Richards, Parker, and Colinelli. Dolly, thank you for joining me today.
Thank you.
And I should also mention that she has been featured on the Florida Legal Guide list of top lawyers, super lawyers list for Miami, and on the list of best lawyers in America, as I mentioned. Dolly, when I say the word divorce, I feel like I'm saying a bad word. Now, without getting into the psychology of it, why is the D word so hated?
I think people don't like the D word. They don't like divorce because no one ever, well, hopefully no one ever marries with the intent to divorce the person that they're marrying, right? But unfortunately, things fall apart. And unfortunately, people get divorced for a number of different reasons. It could be cheating. It could be they have different parenting styles, and you really don't know about parenting styles until you get into it with someone and you have a child, and or you've viewed them with a child from a prior marriage, right? But if you don't have that opportunity to view somebody and their parenting styles, that, believe it or not, is a cause of divorce and financial issues. You have a spendthrift and you have a saver. It's not going to work out.
Well, okay. Before we dig deeper into divorce, we should first probably talk about prenuptial agreements. Is that something that you recommend?
I think that a prenuptial agreement at a minimum is something that couples should discuss. It may not be for everyone, but it's something that the couple should have an open dialogue and basically feel out the other person and determine, is this something that we should do? Is this something that we should explore and get into the conversation of? If they're both open to it, then talk about, well, what are the terms that we would want in this prenuptial agreement? Because you could deal with issues on how you're going to conduct your finances during the marriage, what's going to happen in the event of a divorce, and also in the event that one of the spouses predeceases the other.
Oh.
So all pertinent issues that can be addressed in a prenuptial agreement.
I didn't even know that death of a spouse was covered within a prenuptial agreement. This is why I feel like this is such a great conversation to have. You know, we are learning more about this for sure. I also picked up on something else you said. You said at a minimum when you were describing this. What else should be done?
Well, I at a minimum, and trust and estates, I always typically bring in a trust and estates lawyer if need be to draft the upon death provisions, but also in the event that there's any estate planning that needs to be conducted in addition thereto, that will dovetail with the upon death provisions of the prenuptial agreement.
Oh.
So that's the at a minimum.
Okay. Clearly, for a prenuptial agreement, a trust or other estate plans, you should seek counsel from an attorney. What does the beginning of this process look like?
When I have my consultations, and you can only consult in Florida with one party. I typically advise the individual who will become my client that they should speak to their fiance and talk to them about, are they comfortable with a prenuptial agreement? And if so, some general terms that would be part of this agreement. And then they come back to me and the client and I discuss a framework and how we're going to approach the prenuptial agreement.
Okay. Thinking about that, for many people, talking about the prenuptial agreement can be uncomfortable or difficult, even with their, you know, future spouse. Right. And it's right. Like, I guess I would compare it to a will, right? Like some people don't want to write a will because subconsciously they think that it makes death more real. Therefore, I would assume that many could feel that talking about this could actually cause the dissolution of the marriage later. It makes divorce more real. So when you send your clients to have that conversation with their fiance, how do you prep them for that talk?
I always tell them, you know, honesty is the best policy. If you're going to go into a marriage with someone, you have to put your cards out on the table. So essentially with a prenup, you're doing that. You're basically letting your future spouse know, this is where I stand asset-wise, liability-wise. This is what I'm thinking we should do during our marriage in terms of financial management. Are we going to have one bank account? Are we going to have separate bank accounts? How are we going to conduct our finances? And I think that this is essential because you don't want to marry someone and then start having these conversations, because then potentially it could lead to your marriage breaking down and the D word, right?
Right.
So if you, at the beginning, start addressing these issues, then you could figure out where your fiance stands on a lot of these issues.
Yeah, that sounds like you're looking at this more of like a preventative, right? So that framing it that way might make it feel a little easier for us, right? So, okay. So you also feel that a prenuptial agreement is helpful in getting to know other aspects about our future spouse.
Well, you don't know who you marry until you file for divorce. So the prenuptial agreement is preventative in the sense that you get a sense of the negotiation style and who you're dealing with and what the motivation is for that party, right? You see if they're money motivated, you see if their heart is in it. There's a lot into this negotiation process. And if you can't make it through a negotiation of a prenuptial agreement, then you shouldn't be getting married to that person.
That's actually a really great way to look at it. I mean, really, when you boil it down, getting married, you're entering into a legal agreement that's expected to last for the rest of your life. So if you look at it that way, preparing in advance is probably a good idea. Okay, speaking of lifelong agreements, does the prenuptial agreement last the entire lifespan of the marriage? And even though it's called a prenuptial agreement, is it ever altered as like major life events happen?
You can. And to answer your first question, number one, you can have what's called a sunset provision, meaning let's say you have a couple that basically has nothing to their name, but at some point in the future, if they make it to year 20 or 25, and I'm picking just a random year, they say, at that point, we have a long-term marriage, because in the state of Florida, which is the state I'm licensed in, at year 17, it's a long-term marriage. So if we've reached 20 years, let's just forget about the prenup and put a sunset provision, which means the contract terminates upon the 20th anniversary of the party's marriage. So that's number one. So yes, the contract can terminate by its own terms if there's a sunset provision. Number two, you can modify the contract at some point, but now you're married as opposed to before the marriage, prenuptial agreement. So now potentially you could terminate the prenuptial agreement and do what's called a postnuptial agreement. And at that point, it becomes a little stickier of a situation because you have no bargaining power once you're married. And in terms of what you're actually negotiating for and the like. So a lot of times I don't see that. I don't see a modification or a termination of the prenuptial agreement. But it can happen. You can terminate your prenup and you can enter into a postnuptial agreement.
Oh, okay. Okay. Now that we've got the prenuptial and now I guess postnuptial agreements settled, we should move to the D word. Before we do that, we're going to take a brief break and make sure you listen to the end of the podcast today because we've got a special announcement about learning more that we'll share with you. So be sure to hang in there. We'll be right back after this. If you enjoy history, maybe you're just feeling a little nostalgic, or you wonder who's having a birthday today, or maybe you need a reason to celebrate. Well, we've got the perfect podcast for you. It is called This Is Today. And each and every day, we talk about the historic events, celebrity birthdays. We also talk about whatever is going on today. There's always something to celebrate when you listen to This Is Today. And at just 10 minutes each day, you can make it a daily habit. You can even add it to your Alexa Flash briefing. Click the link in the description or just search in your favorite podcast app for This Is Today. Thanks for listening and subscribing to Learning More. As with any podcast that gives medical or legal opinion, the information is not meant to substitute professional advice. We encourage you to consult a professional to discuss your exact needs. This week, we are talking about family law, specifically prenuptial agreements and divorce with Dolly Hernandez. She is a partner at Boyd, Richards, Parker, and Colonelli, and she is on the list of the best lawyers in America. And I think that that means that I can legally just address you as the best lawyer in America. Okay, so you've spent your law career around family law. As a result, you're dealing with divorce on a daily basis. As we talked about, this is a highly emotional and difficult topic. Why did you choose this field of law?
I like helping people. And family law gives you the opportunity to help people. And I take a somewhat holistic therapeutic approach to family law. I've actually helped people, believe it or not, reconcile. And we're not going to get into the psychology or anything, but sometimes I can see someone who really doesn't want to give up on their marriage. And I basically tell them, if you're not ready to file for divorce, you should attempt some counseling or do something to try and figure out if truly you want to go down that road.
See, there you go again. Another reason why you're one of the best lawyers in America. I mean, what you're saying right now is very rational, you know, but in thinking about divorces, I would think that they're less likely to be in that kind of rational, calm place and more in that high emotion, well, I guess all out war place, right? In thinking about this, though, like a contract, and throughout my professional career, I have negotiated plenty of contracts, and I make it a point to not negotiate from high emotion, because that's when you make bad decisions.
Right.
So you want to try to pull the emotion out if you can. In this, I can imagine trying to pull emotion out of this would be difficult. How do you work through all of that with your clients?
I always advise my client, you're going to have to pay someone, right? If you're going to have to pay your spouse alimony, no one's going to be able to get you out of that situation. If you have to pay child support, you're going to have to pay child support. No one's going to get you out of that situation. No lawyer. So if you're upset that you have to pay money to get divorced because you have to pay spousal support or child support, I always say it's either that or you pay a lawyer. So it's better to pay your family. Obviously, you have to pay the lawyer for their services, but the law is the law is the law. If you have an obligation and you have a duty to pay, the lawyer is going to help you through the process, but you have to take a step back, and you can't demonize your spouse and the opposing party's lawyer and the like. I don't engage in that behavior. I don't believe it's prudent or beneficial to the process. So I always advise the client, realistically, I always tell them, if you have to pay, you have to pay, that's the law. And demonizing people, whether it's your spouse or the process or what they did or didn't do, isn't going to help. And honestly, getting your pound of flesh in court isn't going to happen. It's a very costly process. If you want vengeance, it's not something that you... that's not something that you should seek. It's if you want a divorce, pay what you have to pay, get a clean break, and live a better life. And that's all that you can do.
When I think about this too, I think about that in many cases, there's kids in the picture. What advice do you have for those going through divorce that have kids?
Do not involve your children in the process. And a lot of times, I believe people don't even see that they're involving children in the process. But for instance, an example, let's say someone is picking up a child for timeshare, for visitation, and someone tells the child, well, tell your mom or your dad the following. That's not acceptable, because the adults should be communicating and co-parenting. And sometimes we're people, and we let our anger or emotions get the best of us, but children should not be go-betweens, and they should not be conduits. They should be left out of the process, and the adults should be adults, and the adults should co-parent.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we hear a lot about the cost of high-profile divorces, like, you know, Bill and Melinda Gates, Jeff Bezos, and Mackenzie Scott, and too many others to mention. What are the best ways to help decrease the cost of divorce?
Well, in Florida, you have to exchange financial disclosure, and there's certain disclosures that you must do, and you must file a financial affidavit. I always tell my clients that to help decrease costs, the more organized they are with their documents, bank statements, and tax returns, and preparing their financial affidavit, that helps to decrease the cost of a divorce. If you provide your divorce attorney with just a hodgepodge of different files together, it's more costly to sift through unorganized data than it is to sift through organized data. So I always tell my clients, you're in a driver's seat. The more you help yourself, the more likely it is that this will be less costly for you. So if you provide me with a timeline of relevant events, if you start gathering information, your financial documentation, if the more organized you are, it helps the lawyer and it makes the process less costly.
Yeah, that's great advice. I mean, just like, you know, with taxes, the more documentation and how well those documents are organized will generally save you money.
Right.
Okay. If someone is listening and they're considering starting this process towards divorce, what should they do?
The first step is to determine whether you want to file for divorce, and only that person can make that decision. A lawyer cannot make that decision for you. A lot of times I hear, do you think I should get divorced? And I answer back, I can only tell you what Florida law provides for in the event of a divorce. I cannot tell you whether you should file for divorce. That's an individual decision that needs to be made by the client. So that's one thing, being prepared. Do you want to file for divorce? And are you in an emotional and physical and mental state of mind to file for divorce? Because it's physically grueling, mentally grueling, emotionally grueling, and financially grueling process. So you have to make sure that you can handle it. I always caution everyone so that they know what's in store. And then number two, organization. Start gathering your documents. Keep a timeline of events. If you have children's issues, keep a visitation log. Keep a log of what it is that you do versus your other spouse. And basically, that's the general broad-based information that I provide.
Okay, so divorce law is dependent upon the state in which you live. So if you want somebody representing you within that state, but if someone that is listening right now is in the state of Florida and they wanted to reach out to you, Dolly, how can they find you?
My Instagram handle is Divorce Diva Miami. And the firm website is www.boydlawgroup.com.
Okay, I'll put a link to that in the podcast description. Dolly, thank you so much for joining us today and helping us learn more about family law, prenuptial agreements, and divorce.
Thank you.
And again, as with any podcast that gives medical or legal opinion, the information is not meant to substitute professional advice. We encourage you to consult a professional like Dolly to discuss your exact needs. Okay, for those of you listening, I thank you. I appreciate you. Learning more is so much fun for me, and I enjoy coming up with topics, sourcing guests, and the whole production process is just a lot of fun to me. I really appreciate you taking the time out of your day to listen. As I said earlier in the show, we do have an announcement. This is the end of our first season. Yeah, we're already there. I can't believe it. We are going to take a short break. We will be back. It's not going to be like Stranger Things or Game of Thrones or one of those things where you have to wait a year or two or three for new episodes. No, we are already working on the new episodes, and those will start to appear in less than 2 months. And to whet your appetite, we'll release some teasers between now and then, and I will update you on progress within the daily podcast. This is Today. There's a link to that in the description. I would love you to subscribe to that one as well. If you have something that you would like to learn more about, let us know. Please do that. Go to our podcast website at learningmorepodcast.com and you can submit your ideas and your comments. Again, I thank you for listening. I thank you for subscribing. I'm Russ, and I look forward to learning more with you next season.